Shalom, Rastafari. So now that we're actually posted, we just did a video presentation, and so might as well do something you had in mind, and it's concerning, First Samuel, we believe it's First Samuel, chapter 17. We had planned to title this, The Victory of David over Goliath, and kind of go into how that makes sense, and how in Rastafari Revelation we could kind of see that in a more modern style version type, you know, Old Testament being the archetype in a sense for the things to come. So now let's see if it's actually 1 Samuel chapter 17. We think that it is. So we're actually gonna quickly read over Verse 31 says, is titled, this is, we're referencing from the old Schofield study Bible. So chapter 17, verse 31, we have a title, and it's David's victory over Goliath, which is what we're going to use for this presentation, but we're going to begin reading from verse 45, and it reads, Then said David to the Philistine, Thou comest to me with a sword, and with a spear, and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. This day will the Lord deliver thee into mine hand, and I will smite thee, and take thy head from thee, and I will give the carcasses of the host of the Philistines this day to the fowls of the air, and to all the beasts, the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. I won't. No. And it continues on, verse 37, And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. Okay, so, give it some brief context. At this point in time, Saul is the king of Israel, who the people themselves have chosen themselves to be king over them. Saul, in a true sense, is the people's choice. But now here we have David confronting the giant Goliath. We're sure there's many different true applications to this scripture, but we're going to focus this day on how this victory that David exercises over Goliath is will in the future, in the near future, be kind of like a testament of how David is to be a ruler of a different sort, one that comes in the name of the Almighty, and along with that, the guidance of the divine will, along with David, you know, coming in the name of the Lord. So someone that comes in a different attitude as that which Saul had. And so what we're trying to make known is that this pretty much legitimizes the future reign, legitimizes the title elect of God, being that David exercises victory over Goliath in a very large part in divine guidance, and at least his divine trust and divine relationship with the divine, you know. And so establishing victorious over Goliath and thus kind of legitimizing or certifying that his rule is to be one of a different sort, you know, guided by divine spirit, divine will. So now if we go on forward to 1928, and we're going to reference Wikipedia, and it made mention that October 7th, if we're not mistaken, October 7th, 1928, we have Rastafari crowned Negustafari. So now we have seven exact years from that date. We have, more or less 7 years later, we have a short interruption within the reign of his imperial majesty. We have those haters of Christ, Jesus. In this certain case, we speak of the aggressor, the Italian aggressor, fascist Italian aggressor, along with Vatican Rome, Benito Mussolini, and the supposed king of Italy, the third Emmanuel, King Emmanuel. So we have that interruption. And here we have a situation in which the whole world pretty much figured that it's the end for the Ethiopian kingdom. There's nothing that could possibly be done. And it makes sense in a worldly, non-godly, logical sense. but they do not know that His Majesty is the elect of God, and as did David prove His election through His works, His Majesty will inevitably do the same and fulfill this latter-day revelation. And surely enough, May 5th, 1941, a day that the world must comprehend its entire significance. We're not going to go into that at this exact point in time, but we will make mention that 1941, May 5th, a day that the whole world, not even in their most wildest imaginations, would have ever imagined it coming to pass. The world pretty much assumed it's the death for Haile Selassie first, it's the end of the Ethiopian kingdom. I mean, it was a duel in which a giant Goliath and this more modern type figure would be the Italian army. At this point in time, the Italian army was extremely huge. I mean, we're talking about a strong air force, a strong naval force. I mean, modernized weapons, machine gun fire, missile launchers type, you know, at least that within the ranges of those years, technology, you know, projectile launchers, it would be a better better word to describe, instead of missile launchers, maybe projectile launchers, but highly advanced, highly mechanized tanks, jeep type vehicles, cars, and highly mobilized. So His Imperial Majesty inheriting a humble beginning, a humble Ethiopian old, we dare to say, like old type kingdom. This is what His Imperial Majesty inherited. And so with the armed force of first of all having to unite and get the, you know, acquire the allegiance of the many different nations and kingdoms within the Empire of Ethiopia. We never even thought about that until right now, and that in itself is an extremely difficult task to accomplish, because we must remember that Ethiopia was not just a one country; it was many different kingdoms that did not have to swear allegiance to the King of Kings of Ethiopia. But, you know, that task fulfilled, that in itself was an accomplishment for the record books, we would say, you know, for the history books at least, which they are not including. But nonetheless, going forward, after that task has been realized, now we have an army compounded of a people that lived somewhat like that lived in an environment so much like the ones the very apostles of Jesus Christus would have been accustomed to. A very different environment, a very different mindset. And so now we have the most advanced army and powerful army in the world at that time. Before the rise of the German army, we had the Italians, extremely powerful. And so we have a powerhouse, a national powerhouse, world powerhouse, going up against an army that could only acquire a few, you know, few thousands of more somewhat modern rifles, machine guns. I mean, some 18th century muskets and stuff like that. But I mean, a armed force consisting of barefoot soldiers, some with spears, on horseback. And so a very contrasted, a very widened polar end, I mean, comparing one national force with another imperial force. And so pretty much what we're trying to make known is how the world did not expect the liberation of Ethiopia to have ever come to pass. But behold, weep not, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, you know, has fulfilled and has revealed and has made manifest and has overcome and triumphed against all that the 20th century could possibly throw at him. Overcoming all odds and expectations, he rides in victoriously, triumphant, in the liberation of Ethiopia. And from thence, we liken this to the victory exercised by David over Goliath, legitimizing the title elect of God, surely suyum exiabehe. You know, truly, surely the elect of God, because he cometh in the name of the Almighty, and thus the Almighty liberate him from his enemies, you know, and surely enough, in times with patient being the kingdom of the saints, transforming or converting, making the enemies of Christ Jesus, Yeshua, the Christ, the footstool of the Father, of our Father, Rastafari. And so, we gotta go forward and make sure we said that right. And so, making the enemies of Christ Jesus into the footstool of our Father Majesty. Okay, we just, gotta check that we don't let our excitement kind of like make us say something not necessarily all that certain. So going on forward, now we have another likeness that we'd like to bring forth just to you know, put some information out there that might help those that have been able to receive just a little, that hopefully receiving some of these revelations, that they might hold on tighter and thus with time receive a whole lot more. So, alright, so we're actually looking for 1 Kings chapter 2. And verse 10 reads, okay, so the title here is The Death of David. We're not going to get into the whole death thing, but Rastafari know it, not what death is for. We testify to those things we do see, and we do see the resurrection of the Son and through the Father. So, death overcomed. Rastafari victorious. So now, verse 10, second chapter of 1 Kings reads, so David slept with his fathers, and was buried in the city of David. And the days of David, and the days that David reigned over Israel were 40 years. 7 years reigned he in Hebron, and 33 years reigned he in Jerusalem. So now we're just going to make this final, present this final note. So now, we had made mention that the acquisition or the inheritance of His Majesty's kingdom was a type older, more humble beginning for something that was to be in time, be transformed or become a more splendid, more spectacular reign. And so we likened the first 7 years of the reign of from Nebuchadnezzar, soon to take on His truth as His Majesty, the Mighty Trinity. And so up until the short, I guess, like a interruption, but necessary, thus, you know, fulfilling that those things which must be fulfilled, we have a reign of 7 years, more or less. And so, and we liken this humble beginning of His Majesty reigned, likened to the first 7 years of David reigning upon Hebron, David's city. And then after a short interruption, needless to say, we have the upcoming date of May 5th, 1941. And so from then on, His Imperial Majesty reigns in the Shalom of Yeshua, in the peace of Christ, having transformed the enemies of Christ into His footstool. And so He goes on forward, reigning the next 33 years in Shalom, in the true and spiritual Jerusalem. Up until the careless coup of 1974, we have a reign of His Majesty in this more splendid, more progressive, more majestical empire or kingdom, Ethiopia, you know, with all its glory and, you know, with all the perks of the triumphing over the evils of the world and so on and so forth. And so we liken that to David's 33-year reign in Jerusalem. And so with that, we give thanks for the viewers, and we hope we did a good job.